Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. The topic of today's lecture is the cutaneous markers of internal malignancy. I think this chapter is very important, particularly in those hospitals in which a full-blown oncology services are there. And it is important that you should be aware of all the cutaneous manifestations that are associated with different kind of malignancies. Classification. This topic will be discussed under five different categories, which will show the relationship between skin and internal malignancies. These categories will be multisystem and hemopoietic tumors, direct tumor spread to skin, genetically determined syndrome with cutaneous manifestations, which are also called as the genodermatosis with malignant potential. This category also includes the hematoneoplastic syndromes. Then the fourth are the paraneoplastic disorders. These are the cutaneous reaction patterns that have association with a neoplasm. And lastly, indirect cutaneous markers of internal malignancies. So the first of the category is multisystem and hemopoietic tumors. This category includes a number of tumors in which skin is involved as a part of multisystem neoplasm. The clinical presentation may be with skin lesions only, and it ranges from non-specific signs such as purpura to specific features such as cutaneous deposits of the malignancy. This is different from metastasis from solid tumors because skin involvement is a component of lymphoma and Langerhans cell histiocytosis. That means that there are certain tumors in which skin is involved as a part of usual manifestation of that malignancy. Rather than considering it as a metastasis, the skin is involved as a part of original tumor. The common example is CTCL and Langerhans cell histiocytosis. So this is leukemia cutis, which are the very known skin manifestations of leukemias. Then the second category is the tumor that spread from adjacent or distant tissues. Skin may be involved by a tumor either through direct invasion, through local metastasis, or from cutaneous metastasis from an internal tumor. So these are the three ways in which the skin can be involved. It can be either by direct invasion, by local metastasis, or by distant metastasis. Direct invasion of skin from a deeper tumor usually causes nodular infiltration. It may also cause ulcerated lesions or inflammatory lesions, but may present in less obvious ways, like the dermal infiltration causing sclerosis. This is also called as carcinoma and cuneus. Then it can present as vascular changes, which is called as carcinoma telangiectoides. A PUD orange appearance or a carcinoma erysiploides, which is the inflammatory metastatic carcinoma. Carcinoma and cuneus. It is the skin metastasis of breast cancer by extension, with diffuse carcinomatous, cutaneous, and subcutaneous infiltration that affect chest and abdomen. The early inflammatory stage and may include some nodularity. But later on, the appearance is more of a sclerodermoid-like appearance. So it is also seen in lung, GI, renal, and some other malignancies, but typically carcinoma and cutaneous is described with breast malignancy. Carcinoma erysipelas. The clinically, it resembles erysipelas and presents as warm edematous tender plaque, but without pyrexia or toxemia. Histologically, there is plugging of dermal lymphatics by carcinoma cells. And this is again seen commonly in breast, but also reported with SCC, melanoma, mesothelioma, CA lung, prostate, esophagus, bladder, colon, larynx, rectum, stomach, and pancreas. So many, many of the GI malignancies and genitourinary malignancies. All these are direct tumor spreads. Then telangiectatic metastatic carcinoma. This is typically associated with breast cancer, but is difficult to diagnose as tumor cells are quite scanty and telangiectasia is quite subtle. Sometimes vascular changes become more florid, and in such cases, the skin lesions resemble angiosarcomas. So these are the different skin manifestation by direct tumor spread. It can be in a form of nodular infiltration. This is carcinoma and cutaneous, which is scleroderma-like appearance, then carcinoma erysipelas, then PUD orange appearance, all because of direct invasion of the skin. Tumor spillage. Local spread of tumor occur after diagnostic or therapeutic intervention, such as needle aspiration, pleural biopsy, drainage of malignant ascites, or by direct contamination of wounds with tumor cells during laparoscopy or surgical procedure. The incidence is very less, that is 0.8%. Cutaneous metastasis. Metastasis to the skin is not as common as metastasis to liver, lung, or bone, but they still account for 9% of overall metastasis. The most common cancers which metastasize to the skin are the breast, melanoma, lung, upper aerodigestive tract, stomach, colon, uterus, and kidney. Appearance of skin metastasis. Cutaneous metastasis generally present as painless, firm to hard nodules, which may be skin-colored, blue-brown, or red in. Solitary nodule is twice as frequent as multiple nodules. Ulceration of nodules may also occur. Other patterns of skin metastasis include morphea or sclerotic plaques, infiltration of scars, erysipelas-like diffuse skin infiltration, as I have already told you. Infiltration area of alopecia, which is called as alopecia neoplastica, and embolic metastasis to the digits. This is alopecia neoplastica. This is embolic metastasis to the digits. These are the vascular metastasis, and these are the nodules, multiple nodules seen on the skin. You have to take the skin biopsy to prove and determine the histogenesis of that tumor by immunohistochemistry. Sometimes these lesions occur secondary to the diagnosis of the tumor. So in such cases, if such metastases are biopsied and found to contain the malignant tumor, it is not required to go for immunohistochemistry as it can be linked to the original primary tumor. The mechanism and distribution. Metastasis to the skin occur as a result of lymphatic or hematogenous dissemination. Metastasis to the adjacent skin is suggestive of dissemination by means of lymphatics or by veins. Metastasis to extremities suggest intra-arterial embolic spread. Then widespread skin metastasis suggests that the tumor has infiltrated the general circulation. 75% of metastases are found on head and neck and upper trunk. Other notable sites include umbilicus, a very characteristic lesion, which is called a Sister Mary Joseph nodule in bowel tumors. Scar metastases occur after surgery. of the primary tumor. Then metastases also occur, also are localized at the site of irradiation of the skin. An unusual metastasis is tumor to tumor spread, that is, metastasis of a malignant tumor to a benign tumor, for example, a lipoma. Prognosis. Cutaneous metastasis usually suggestive of disseminated disease and indicate poor prognosis. So when the skin metastases occur, the survival is in the range of 3 months. Patients with solitary metastasis have a better survival as compared to those with multiple metastases at different sites. Treatment options include excision or destructive therapy, that is laser destruction, radiotherapy, photodynamic therapy, and chemotherapy. Paget's disease. Paget's disease occurs in mammary and extramammary form. Paget disease of the breast occurs due to an underlying ductal tumor. Extramammary Paget disease, however, may occur without an underlying tumor. So, does not link with direct tumor spread. Then, few words about the Paget's disease of the breast. Patients usually present with a scaling, erythema, and sometimes oozing or crusted lesions over the nipple. Clinically, the lesion look like an eczema, but the history is long and the disease is unilateral, and maybe there is a history of previously diagnosed primary ductal tumor of the breast. It is generally viewed as direct epidermal extension of underlying ductal adenocarcinoma. The reason of epidermotropic spread is due to a keratinocyte-derived chemoattractant termed as the herigulin alpha. Those cases that do not have an underlying carcinoma are derived from the Toker cells, which are seen in epidermis of nipple and areola. This is Paget's disease of the breast. Extramammary Paget's disease occur in apocrine gland bearing area such as anogenital and axillary site. Mainly it is in anogenital site. So 60% of cases occur on vulva, 20% perianal, and 50% penile or scrotum. The histogenesis is less certain in extramammary Paget disease, and only 25% of the patients will have an invasive malignancy. The clinical features include a burning sensation or itch, edema, bleeding, reddish-brown discoloration, plaque with prominent margins. Histological and immunohistochemical features are similar to those of primary Paget's disease. This is extramammary Paget's disease. Then the third category of involvement of skin with tumors is the genodermatosis that are associated with internal malignancies. A number of genodermatoses are associated with internal malignancies, and mechanisms involved include chromosomal instability, faulty DNA repair mechanisms, abnormal lymphocyte functions, immunosurveillance, and combination of these processes. Howell-Evans syndrome. Howell-Evans syndrome is an autosomal dominant disorder characterized by focal palmoplantar keratoderma with eventual development of esophageal carcinoma. Oral leukoplakia is also frequent. Nevoid basal cell carcinoma or the Gorlin syndrome. It is an association between multiple basal cell carcinomas, mandibular odontogenic keratocysts, skeletal anomalies, abnormal calcification, and dyskeratotic pits on palm and soles. Patients with the syndrome has increased tendency of developing medulloblastomas, ovarian tumors, and rare CNS tumors. Familial melanoma syndrome. Typically, one or more of the following is present in such patients: a family history of melanoma, or a personal history of multiple atypical melanocytic nevi, or a family history of multiple atypical melanocytic nevi. There are large, multiple, and irregular nevi and early onset of melanoma. Multiple primary melanomas may occur, and sometimes non-cutaneous malignancies. There is a germline mutation of 9p21 gene. There is 22-fold increased risk of developing pancreatic or breast carcinomas. Xeroderma pigmentosa. This present in early age with severe photosensitivity, and there is marked reduction in threshold of sunburn. It presents with multiple lentigens, principally on sun-exposed distribution, early onset of photoaging, followed by sun-induced dysplasias, multiple actinic keratosis, basal cell carcinomas, and malignant melanomas. It's an autosomal recessive inheritance and results from defective DNA nucleotide exchange repair process. There is inactivation of tumor suppressor gene and activation of oncogenes. There is 10 to 20-fold increase incidence of internal malignancies, mainly CNS sarcomas, leukemias, and carcinomas of lung, breast, stomach, pancreas, and testes. Fawn-Hippel-Lindau disease. It's an autosomal dominant disease, and there is a non-specific cutaneous manifestations like hemangiomas and caffeolimacules, characterized by benign and malignant tumors, particularly hemangioblastomas of CNS, angiomatosis of retina, pheochromocytoma, renal carcinoma, pancreatic adenoma, carcinoma, or cysts. Neurofibromatosis type 1 and 2, Fawn-Rickling-Hansen disease. There are two types, 1 and 2, both are autosomal dominant. In neurofibroma 1, there are multiple peripheral neurofibromas, as well as CNS tumors, such as optic glioma. There is some clinical overlap between type 1 and type 2, particularly in children. Patients have multiple caffeolimacules, multiple neurofibromas, axillary freckling, leash nodules, and patients of neurofibromas have 2.5-fold increased risk of developing malignancy. The most common is neurofibrosarcoma. And neurofibromatosis 2 patients develop vestibular and peripheral nerve schwannomas. Tuberous sclerosis complex. Tuberous sclerosis consists of angiokeratoma, epilepsy, and learning difficulties. Tuberous sclerosis is an autosomal dominant condition. Other skin findings, CNS, renal, and cardiopulmonary systems are most significantly affected. Angiolipomas of vessel, fat, and smooth muscles occur. Renal cell carcinoma is a well-recognized tumor association. Then multiple endocrine neoplasms type 1 or Wermeer syndrome. This is a familial cancer syndrome associated with cancer with three cancers with P, that is parathyroid, pancreas, and pituitary. Typically, multiple facial angiofibromas, cholangiomas, and lipomas. Caffeolimacules are also seen. Mutation is in MEN1 gene. Metastasis from malignant neuroendocrine tumors, particularly malignant pancreatic or thymic carcinoid tumor, is one of the commonest cause of mortality. Then multiple endocrine neoplasms type 2A. Type 2A and 2B involve principally thyroid and parathyroid, adrenal medulla, and is because of RET photo-oncogene mutation. Both are autosomal dominant, and multiple endocrine neoplasms 2A. There will be pruritic skin lesions underlying the scapular area, and the triad of clinical manifestations include a medullary thyroid carcinoma, pheochromocytoma, and hyperparathyroidism. Multiple endocrine neoplasm type 2B are more important as far as skin manifestations are concerned and are characterized by mucosal neuromas that are apparent at birth or in first year of life and manifest as soft flesh-colored papules or nodules. They cause soft, lumpy or blueberry protuberant lips, bumpy eyelids and prominent eyebrows. The neuromas typically affect the mucosal surfaces on the tongue, buccal mucosa, gingiva, palate and pharyngeal surfaces. 75% of patients have marfanoid appearance and there is muscle weakness and musculoskeletal anomalies. Multiple endocrine 2B is associated with thyroidmedullary thyroid carcinoma and 75% and pheochromocytoma in 50% of patients. Then another hematomatous syndrome is carne complex or myxoma syndrome. This is also an interesting syndrome which is characterized by cutaneous pigmentary lesions with cutaneous, subcutaneous and internal myxomas. There are associated endocrinopathies involving adrenal gland, thyroid, pituitary and gonads. A name syndrome is comprising of N stands for congenital melanocytic nevi, then A for atrial myxomas, M for myxoid neurofibromas, and E for aphelids. Then Lamb syndrome consists of lentigens, atrial myxomas, mucocutaneous myxomas, and blue nevi. So pigmentary macules, which are in form of aphelids or lentigens, is the commonest manifestation, skin manifestation, along with multiple myxomas. Three of the major diagnostic criteria involve skin, which is spotty cutaneous pigmentation on lip, conjunctiva, eyelid, and genitals, then mucocutaneous myxoma and blue nevi. Then PTEN hematoma tumor syndrome, also called as Cowden syndrome. The Cowden syndrome is characterized by multiple facial trichelomas, at least three should be present, acral keratosis, at least six palmar lesions, then cobblestone hyperplasia on the tongue on mucosal surfaces. And this is found in 90% of the patient. Other cutaneous lesions include ganglioneuromas, lipoma, fibroma, angioma, angiolipoma, and cysts. Benign internal anomalies affect the breast and thyroid mainly. Gastrointestinal polyps and cysts of female genitourinary tract may also be seen, but mainly thyroid and breast. Muir-Torre syndrome, another common skin hematomatous syndrome. And this genodermatosis is associated with cutaneous sebaceous carcinomas, adenomas, or sebaceomas, and to less extent keratoacanthoma and internal malignancy. It's autosomal dominant, and internal malignancy associated is colonic and urogenital, mainly GI and urogenital, then in addition, breast and hematological also. Bloom syndrome, Rothman-Thompson, and Werner syndrome. They are all autosomal recessive and rare and are all caused by RECQ helicase gene mutation. The Bloom syndrome, the subjects are small statured, have sun-sensitive telangiectatic facial rashes and caffeolae macules. There is deficient cell and humoral immunity and associated with lymphoproliferative neoplasms and tumors of aerodigestive and lower GI tracts. Rothman-Thompson, characterized by developmental anomalies in the skin and skeletal system, photosensitivity, poikiloderma, small stature, premature aging, and juvenile cataract. So in addition to photosensitivity, poikiloderma is characteristic of Rothman-Thompson. And there's a predilection of certain malignancies, especially the osteosarcoma, fibrosarcoma, and myelodysplasias. The Werner syndrome is adult progeria. The condition is premature aging. Onset is second to third decade of life. Key features, short statured, early graying and hair loss, bilateral cataract and scleroderma-like skin changes. Neoplasm occur in 10% of cases and are sarcomas, melanomas, leukemias, meningiomas, and some epithelial-derived carcinomas. Wiskott-Aldrich syndrome. It is an X-linked recessive immunosuppressive deficiency syndrome characterized by bleeding, susceptibility to infection, and severe eczema. The older patient have risk of autoimmune disorder and lymphoid malignancies like non-Hodgkin, leukemias, and some cerebral tumors. Shirakigashi. It is a fatal autosomal recessive disorder with feature of oculocutaneous albinism, silver hairs, photophobia, neurological abnormalities, and severe recurrent bacterial infections. Although strongly suggestive of lymphoma, infiltrate of affected organ is reported to be reactive rather than neoplastic. Ataxia telangiectasia. It is an autosomal recessive condition characterized by cerebral ataxia that is progressive and oculocutaneous telangiectasias. There is premature aging of skin and hair, non-infectious cutaneous granulomas, which have a tendency to ulcerate. There is progressively immune deficiency, both cell-mediated and humoral type, and tumor-associated are lymphoproliferative B-cell or leukemia T-cells. Dyskeratosis congenita is a multi-system inherited syndrome characterized by mucocutaneous abnormalities, bone marrow failure, and predisposition to cancers. Inheritance is by X-linked recessive, by AR and AD. Triad of abnormalities include reticulate hyperpigmentation, nail dyskeratosis, and leukoplakia. Aplastic anemia occur in 50%, and oropharyngeal carcinoma is the commonest association. Then Fanconi anemia. It is characterized by diverse congenital malformation, progressive pancytopenia, and predisposition to hematological malignancies. Dermatologically, Fanconi anemia is characterized by pigmentation, which can be diffuse, mottled, or caffeine macule-like. If it is diffuse, it is accentuated at neck and over the joints. Scattered area of hyperpigmentation may also be seen. So Fanconi anemia is characterized by diffuse or mottled pigmentation and characterized by acute myeloid leukemia and solid tumor of head and neck or gynecological squamous cell carcinoma. The fourth category of skin lesions associated with malignancies are called as the paraneoplastic syndromes. The paraneoplastic dermatoses are the skin conditions that have an association with internal malignancies, but are not themselves malignant. The likelihood of finding a neoplasm may be graded as high, intermediate, or low. Following are few definitive characteristics of paraneoplastic lesions. The first is that the malignancy and the cutaneous disorders occur concurrently, both at the same time. The two disorders follow the same parallel course, and there is statistical association between the two, genetic association between the two, and there should be a specific tumor site. Among the paraneoplastic syndrome, the first is acanthotic and ichthyotic epidermal disorder, in which we are going to discuss the acanthosis nigricans first. Acanthosis nigricans can be benign or malignant. Benign is usually associated with obesity and insulin resistance, but the malignant acanthosis nigricans has a rapid onset and progression to produce symmetrical, rugose, velvety papules and plaques. Axilla and flexural sites are involved, and commonest association is with a GI malignancy. Then acanthosis palmaris, described as thickening of skin of palm and occasionally sole with velvety honeycomb appearance. It occurs in combination with malignant acanthosis nigricans or lesser trillate sign, and is particularly associated with gastric, genitourinary, or lung malignancy. Sign of lesser trillate, the sudden development of numerous seborrheic keratoses in an eruptive fashion with or without pruritus is called as lesser trillate sign. This sign is a sign of neoplasm and tumor are mainly adenocarcinoma of GI tract. However, breast and lymphoproliferative carcinomas are also associated. Florid cutaneous papillomatosis, a rare paraneoplastic phenomena characterized by widespread pruritic eruption of warty papules and associated with gastric adenocarcinoma. Acquired ichthyosis, sudden onset of ichthyosis in a pattern of ichthyosis vulgaris occur in adults as usually a sign of internal malignancy, most commonly Hodgkin's disease in 70% of cases, also seen in T-cell lymphoma, leukemias, myelodysplastic syndromes, multiple myelomas, and polycythemia vera. Other epidermal disorder, pityriasis rotunda, is a fixed annular scaly dermatosis associated with hepatocellular carcinoma. Transient acantholytic dermatosis or Grover's disease is linked with myelogenous leukemias and GI and carcinoma of genitourinary tract. Then seed-like keratosis with arsenical ingestion may also be associated with internal malignancy. Paraneoplastic pigmentation. This is ectopic ACTH syndrome, which is also associated with gastric, pancreatic, esophageal, and ovarian, as well as carcinomas, as well as thymoma, pheochromocytoma, and carcinoid syndrome. Pigmentation in ectopic ACTH is Addisonian type, diffuse but with photoaggravation, and greater prominence over the pressure areas. So pigmentation can be a paraneoplastic sign. Then hypertrichosis lanugosa accusata. The development of hairs in acquired fashion, especially on the face, extending down to the body, is a sign of internal malignancy. The hairs usually are not terminal, but fine, downy, and lanugo type. Commonest site is the form of the tumor is the lung, followed by colorectal, and in women, colorectal first, followed by lung and breast. Clubbing of nails, you all know what clubbing is. It is commonly associated with carcinoma of bronchus, with mesothelioma, malignancy of cardiovascular, GI, and hepatobiliary systems. Hyperhidrosis is a common association with pheochromocytoma, lymphoma, and carcinoid syndrome. Then the category is the dermatoses, which are associated with internal malignancies. These dermatoses should be separated from paraneoplastic syndromes. The criteria of diagnosis of paraneoplastic syndrome, I have already mentioned before. So dermatoses which are associated with internal malignancy include acrokeratosis paraneoplastica or the Basic syndrome. It is a rare paraneoplastic condition that is particularly associated with squamous cell carcinoma of upper respiratory or GI tract. The cutaneous changes are violaceous, erythema, and scaling on the helices of ear, tips of the nose, hand, and feet. Eruption become more hyperkeratotic with keratoderma of hand and feet, and changes on feet resemble eczema or lupus erythematosus. Migratory erythemas. There are two variants of migratory erythema. There is erythema gyratin repens and necrolytic migratory erythema, which are associated with internal malignancy. Erythema gyratin repens is a rare, bizarre cutaneous eruption which is characterized by concentric erythematous bands giving a wood grain appearance. And it is commonly associated in 80% of cases with lung carcinoma. Then necrolytic migratory erythema is strongly associated with glucagon secreting alpha cell tumor of pancreas. Present as painful migratory rash with irregular polycyclic intensely inflammatory erythematous patches with extending scaling margin. Blisters may form and necrolysis may occur. Predilection of anogenital region. And it is also associated with weight loss, diabetes, stomatitis, and diarrhea. This is erythema gyratum repens, and this is necrolytic migratory erythema. Connective tissue and rheumatological disorders. We have read it previously. Dermatomyositis is commonly associated with internal malignancies, mainly lung cancer in men, breast and gynecological tumor in women, and colorectal tumors in both sexes. NXP2 and NTTIF1 gamma antibodies are frequently associated with dermatomyositis with malignancies. Lupus erythematosus, the possibility of internal malignancy is less and controversial, but is associated with lymphoma, monoclonal gammopathy, cervical, lung, hepatobiliary, and breast carcinomas. Systemic sclerosis and inflammatory fibrosing conditions. Systemic sclerosis may be associated with increased risk of lung, liver, hematological, and bladder cancers. Eosinophilic fasciitis is also associated with malignancies. Some form of panniculitis occur with SNR cell carcinoma of pancreas. Eosinophilic panniculitis is associated with solid tumors and pre-leukemias, and scleroderma-like skin changes occur with cutaneous carcinoid syndrome. Paraneoplastic pemphigus has a diverse clinical manifestation, and the skin lesions are a mixture of pemphigus and Stevens-Johnson syndrome, commonly associated with Hodgkin lymphoma, chronic lymphocytic leukemia, Castleman tumor, thymoma, spindle cell neoplasms, and Wald and Strom macroglobulinemia. Bullous pemphigoid is associated with lung, thyroid, larynx, skin, soft tissue, stomach, colon, lymphoreticular, prostate, cervix, bladder, kidney, and uterus cancers, or long list of cancers. It is a chance association, or since the disease develops in old age, is a usual association, it cannot be said with certainty. Pemphigus is usually not associated with cancer, but sometimes it may be associated with thymoma and Castleman tumor, pemphigus foliaceus with hepatocellular carcinoma, and pemphigus in Japanese patient with lung cancer. DH is associated with enteropathy and associated T-cell lymphoma, linear IgA disease with lymphoproliferative malignancy, EBA with myeloma and lymphoma, and PCT with hepatocellular carcinomas. Deposition disorders. Amyloid is a paraproteinemia associated with paraproteinemias and myelomas. Mucinosis and lipid storage diseases associated with paraproteinemias. Calcification in the skin occur with gammopathy, pancreatic, and multiple endocrine neoplasms. Then vascular disorders, which are associated with internal malignancies, we have to discuss them separately because most there are very typical features which are vasculitic and associated with internal malignancy. Raynaud's phenomena and digital ischemia. Persistent painful digital ischemia with unusual Raynaud's in summers predisposing to gangrene is seen with various solid tumor and reticuloendothelial neoplasms. Hyperviscosity syndrome like polycythemia vera, leukemia, and myeloma-linked cryoglobulinemia give rise to cutaneous ischemias, filibitis by microvascular occlusion. Cancer-associated coagulopathy may also cause vascular occlusions. And hypereosinophilic carcinoma syndrome is associated with acrocyanosis and digital infarcts and gangrene. Erythromelalgia, a condition, is associated with myeloproliferative disorders, particularly polycythemia vera and essential thrombocythemias. There is burning pain and erythema, and symptoms occur for 2 years or more before the malignancy is picked up. Palmar erythema, the increased vascular link to vascularity of tumors, particularly seen with high-grade astrocytoma and glioblastoma. There is a role of vascular endothelial growth factor. 20% had palmar and lesser extent plantar erythema. Vasculitis, associated with myeloproliferative disorders and myeloma and solid tumors. 200 patients with ANCA-associated vasculitis have six-fold increased risk of malignancy. Dermatological manifestation of vasculitis associated with malignancy include palpable purpura, maculopapular, urticarial, or petechial lesions. Chilblain-like lesions may also occur with malignancies, particularly leukemias and myeloproliferative disorders, and they would not respond to calcium channel blockers. Flushing is a feature of carcinoid syndrome. of mastocytomas, of free chromocytomas, of medullary carcinoma of thyroid, hypogonadism in males, and pancreatic tumor secreting V-isoactive intestinal peptide, which are called as V-ipomas, and renal cell carcinoma. So long list of tumors causing flushing. Carcinoid syndrome is seen in about 10% of patients have malignant carcinoid syndrome characterized by paroxysms of flushing and gradual development of fixed cyanotic erythema. Other symptoms are diarrhea, abdominal pain, dyspnea, wheeze, and syncope. 75% of carcinoid tumors are in GI tract and 25% in bronchial. Mastocytosis, more aggressive forms tend not to be associated with cutaneous mast cell lesions, but flushing, dyspnea, chest pain, abdominal cramps, palpitation, syncope may occur. Serum tryptase is useful screening test, which is usually high. Few chromocytomas are associated with pallor, rebound flushing, and hyperhidrosis. Medullary carcinoma of thyroid, like few chromocytomas, may be a part of multiple endocrine neoplasms and cause symptoms of diarrhea. Cancer-associated thrombosis. So tumors can cause thrombosis, which resulting in thrombophlebitis, DVT, or Mondor disease. Migratory thrombophlebitis is associated with recurrent and with associated with neoplasms, particularly the neoplasms, particularly solid organ neoplasms, and characterized by recurrent and migratory thrombophlebitis called as the thrombocytes. Upper extremity and trunk is involved. Then DVTs. There is finding malignancy is increased in about fourfold in patient with DVT of leg. And if DVT is seen on the limb, then it is more likely linked with neoplasms. Usually their tumor associated are adenocarcinoma of GI tract, urogenital tract, breast and lung. Mondor disease is a rare condition characterized by cord-like lesions that are palpable in subcutaneous tissue of anterior lateral thorax and sometimes abdomen. Underlying lesion is again a thrombophlebitis of thoracic or epigastric vein and result from trauma, inflammation, or post-surgery. 10 to 15% cases are associated with breast neoplasms. So this is different from migratory thrombophlebitis as the lesions are typically seen on thoracic or epigastric areas, which the other one occur on the limbs. Venous or lymphatic obstruction occur due to several malignancies. So occlusion of venous flow can occur due to benign retrosternal goiter and seen when arms are elevated called as Pemberton sign. Lymphatic obstruction and lymphedema typically occur with breast cancer. Pruritus. There are different kinds of pruritus that are associated with malignancy. The first is the paraneoplastic pruritus. The internal carcinoma is non-specific but important cause of pruritus, and treatment of internal carcinoma treats the pruritus. Basic mechanism includes secondary metabolic effects like uremia or cholestasis, iron deficiency or acquired ichthyosis or xerosis. Then generalized pruritus or itching occur with Hodgkin's disease, Sézary syndrome, mycosis fungoides, myelomatosis, and leukemias. Several visceral carcinomas are also characterized by generalized pruritus like breast, GI tract, and carcinoid. Echogenic pruritus is characteristic of polycythemia vera and lymphoproliferative disease, treated by opiate, antagonist, antidepressant, and neuroleptics. Localized pruritus, seen with neuropathic pain or pruritus, especially neck, shoulder, arm due to spinal tumor. Brain tumor is also a cause of localized pruritus. So that ends today's lecture. So I thank you all for a very patient listening. Goodbye and have a good, nice weekend.